Kippy was born 50 years ago, in 1963. It was the beginning of a new era for the Canadian labor movement, an era that gave rise to profound change in Canada. QP soon grew into the largest union, the most diverse union, a militant force for the rights of workers and citizens. QP has changed the landscape of our country and of our province. We're going to pay tribute to our great union's history through film, poetry, and speeches.
But first, let us introduce you to some very special guests and heroes of our movement. The past officers of QP Ontario who sacrificed so much to build the legacy that we have all inherited.
Fred Taylor, president from 1962 to 1963.
Bruce Martin, secretary treasurer, 1963 to 1974.
Percy Huguet. Grace Hartman, president from 1963 to 1967. Percy Huguet, president 1967 to 1972. Shirley Carr, president from 1972 to 1974. Sam Dobbin, president 1974 to 1976.
Don Watt, secretary treasurer 1976 to 1978.
Lucy Allen, president 1976 to 1988. Stand, sister, please.
Randy Millage, secretary treasurer 1978 to 1980. Terry O'Connor, secretary treasurer 1980 to 1996.
Michael Stokes, president 1988 to 1992. Sid Ryan, president 1992 to 2009.
Brian O'Keefe, secretary treasurer 1996 to 2006.
Sisters and brothers, we thank you for your leadership, your passion, your vision, and all that you have done to build our union. We pledge to you that we will do all we can to build on your work, to continue to organize, to keep fighting for justice. Thank you.
I now want to give the floor to another special guest who is joining us by video from her new home province of British Columbia. Judy Darcy, who served many years as an executive board member of QP Ontario and first vice president of QP Ontario, was elected as QP National Secretary Treasurer in 1989 and then served as QP National President from 1991 to 2003. Judy very much wanted to attend this 50th convention to honor the important role QP Ontario played in her life. But the recent BC election got in the way of that plan. Judy Darcy was a candidate in the new Westminster, and I'm happy to tell you that she won that seat for the NDP. With the government planning to reconvene the legislature as soon as possible, Judy wasn't able to make the trip to Toronto, but she shared a video message with us instead.
Howdy, I'm Judy Darcy, and I so very much would have liked to be there with you this week to celebrate QP Ontario's 50th birthday. But you might have heard I've been a little busy. I just got elected as the MLA for New Westminster in the BC Provincial Legislature. We didn't win a majority government, but you know, we know with 4 more years of Liberal rule, we know what that means. It means more cuts, more privatization, more attacks on trade union rights, and in the case of BC, more tankers and more pipelines. So our job is going to be to hold the Liberal government's feet to the fire, and that's why I can't be there today. But you know, I was an activist in QP Ontario for 17 years. Before that, I was involved in the student movement, the women's movement, and the peace movement. But in my 17 years in QP Ontario, including on the division executive board, I was involved in building coalitions against cutbacks, fighting for pay equity, organizing strike support, and among other things, fighting to establish a women's committee in QP Ontario, which you may be surprised to know, back in the 1980s, we didn't have any equity committees or women's committee. It took us several years to get a women's committee established in the Constitution. And you know, it took several more years after that before it was agreed that the women's committee should be made up of women. I was elected to the QP Ontario Executive Board in 1984, but you know, I attended every single QP Ontario convention from the mid-1970s until I stepped down as national president in 2003. And you know, QP Ontario has always been my home. QP Ontario was a place where we brought together the entire diversity of QP's membership in Ontario to support each other, to stand up and to campaign for the vital services that we deliver to the public. But it was also a place where we came together for economic and for social justice. And you know what? We need QP Ontario now as much as we did 50 years ago because of all the challenges ahead. I want to take a minute to salute some folks. I want to salute Keeley Cummings, one of the founding fathers of our great union. He's the last living member of the original merger committee that brought NUPE and NUPSI together to create QP in 1963. I want to salute the past officers of QP Ontario, those who are still alive and those who have passed on, for their absolutely huge role in building QP in Ontario. I want to congratulate Fred and Candace for the tremendous leadership that they're giving to QP Ontario right now, standing up for workers' rights, locals coming together to stand up for the vital services that we deliver, and also for their leadership on political action, because getting involved in politics is an absolute necessity for working people and for their families. But you know, most of all, I want to pay tribute to all of you, to the frontline activists, whether you've been around for a while or whether you're new to activism, the frontline activists of QP, and to our staff, because you are the heart and soul of the Canadian Union of Public Employees. You always have been, and you always will be. That's what the Canadian Union of Public Employees is all about. This week, you're going to be celebrating 50 years of QP Ontario, of organizing, of building, of growing, of successes, of activism. And what a celebration it's going to be. I know you're going to have a grand time, and I really wish I could have been there. Happy 50th birthday, QP Ontario. Here's to another 50 years of activism, of growth, and of success.
It's good to see Judy again, isn't it? And still proudly wearing QP's colors, as you can all see. Thank you, Judy.
To help us commemorate this special celebration of QP's legacy and our achievements together, Brother Leo Diaz is creating a live work of art right here before us that he will present to QP Ontario this afternoon. Leo is a custodian at Peel Catholic School Board and a QP member from Local 1483. He's also a talented artist who painted a moving portrait of Jack Layton for us at the QP Has Talent event at last year's convention. Thank you, brother, and once again for sharing your wonderful art with us, and we'll see you this afternoon.
QP's 50-year history is a story of struggle. It's a story of workers coming together to demand justice, not just for ourselves, but for our communities. for the people who have no unions to defend them. Our history is made up of so many stories, some of them well known, some of them not so much. The following video captures only a few, but it describes where we came from and some of what has happened along the way to help to make us who we are. We hope you enjoy it.
Now, are you ready for the big moment, brothers and sisters?
We are here today to send a very clear message, not just to the Liberals, but to every politician in Ontario. We will never forget that they stripped people's democratic rights to free collective bargaining with Bill 115.
This is what we need to do more of, because it's not going to get any easier.
It's fundamentally a struggle to make the world understand that the public sector is what delivers public good.
What an amazing turnout here today!
Let's make our voices heard. Let's stand tall and let labor and other community partners know that QP women stand with them shoulder to shoulder in our struggle for equality.
From Kingston to Cassis Casey, from Timmins to Tillsonburg, from Ottawa to Windsor. Stay strong! So, so, so!
Solidarity! So, so, so! Solidarity! So, so, so!
On September 24th, 1963, the members of the National Union of Public Employees and the National Union of Public Service Employees decided to join together into one strong collective voice, the Canadian Union of Public Employees, QP. Recognizing that politics impact collective bargaining and workers' rights directly, QP created provincial divisions that are the union's political arm. QP Ontario started out with 22,174 members. Today, with more than 240,000 members, we are the largest union in the province and a strong political voice for equality, social justice, and the public service we provide. Our members are municipal workers, healthcare workers, social service workers, school board workers, university workers, and airline workers. Living and working in every community across Ontario, our proud history of collective bargaining and political action has improved the rights and standard of living for all Ontarians. Our public fight for collective bargaining rights began in July of 1964, when Perth public utility workers went on strike for union recognition. Soon, they were joined by 14 custodial and clerical workers at Chelmsford High School, who struck for recognition. Section 89 of the Labor Relations Act allowed local governments to opt out of union certification and conciliation. These QP members were not alone. In 1965, Bill 41 took away the right to strike for hospital employees. Not long after, hundreds of QP Ontario members took to the lawn of Queen's Park for the first mass demonstration of public sector workers. On the steps of the legislature, Ontario Division President Grace Hartman read the Bill of Wrongs, outlining 10 laws that explicitly discriminated against public employees.
The patience of the public employee is fast being pushed beyond the limits of endurance.
This unprecedented show of collective action forced the government to repeal Section 89 of the Labor Relations Act. QP Ontario had established itself as a political force to be reckoned with, and members saw the power of collective action. The 1960s saw many gains for QP members and Ontarians. Increases to wages and benefits, shorter wait time for vacation, and the historic agreement by London Local 101, which eliminated wage discrimination against female workers by ending the practice of two-tiered wages. After fighting for basic collective bargaining rights in the 60s, public sector workers faced a new threat in the 70s with federal government wage and price controls. Without consulting the legislature, Ontario's Conservative Treasurer signed an agreement making 400,000 provincial public sector workers subject to this federal law. QP Local 1230 at the University of Toronto were the first workers in Canada to challenge this legislation. By striking in October of 1975 against wage and price controls, followed up with legal action. Mobilizing grew in our union and across Canada, and by the end of the decade, wage and price controls were gone. Through long, hard work, political and job action had won the day. In the early 1980s, QP Ontario's hospital workers faced a key fight. In the fall of 1980, government fiscal restraint programs slashed hospital budgets. Support staff positions were eliminated and workloads were doubled. While their workloads increased, hospital workers' real earnings, like others in the broader public sector, experienced a 20% loss to inflation between 1976 and 1980.
What the hospitals did was sort of spit in the face of the self-esteem of our membership. All that anger exploded in the strike of 1981.
And it's time we turn the guns around.
Angry at working conditions, mismanagement, stagnant wage levels, and demands for concessions, workers saw collective action as the way to restore the balance, their rights, and good working conditions.
And we're prepared to defy legal obstacles or powerful obstacles if they thought that they were wrong.
On January 26th, 1981, QP members went on illegal strike to stand up for fairness and public services.
You know, this was a time of great mobilization, really, across the working class, of which we were an example.
By midweek, 14,000 workers at 51 hospitals were on the streets. By the fifth day of the strike, the Ontario Supreme Court ordered workers to return to their jobs. Members who were landed immigrants received intimidating phone calls and were threatened with deportation.
And the Ministry of the Attorney General are pursuing whatever actions are necessary to bring those who are in contempt of the injunction before the court to answer for their actions.
Illegal fines, like nailed on the posters where we're picketing the telephone poles, you know, 1,000 a day, whatever. These are people, they don't have homes, you know, like, you know, they're renting apartments.
Threat of fines doesn't really bother anybody because as hospital workers, we don't have the $1,000 a day to pay anyway.
QP National President Grace Hartman, QP Ontario President Lucy Nicholson, and National Representative Ray Arsenault were given jail sentences after QP members defied back-to-work orders. The harsh sentences sent shockwaves through the labor movement. In retaliation for the strike, 34 local union leaders from 12 hospitals were fired, and almost 10,000 other members were suspended or received other disciplinary actions.
Well, we just felt defeated. This was just terrible. That was an awful letdown. It was totally unfair.
These combined tactics only served to strengthen workers' resolve. They fought back the proposed concessions. They also formed the Ontario Council of Hospital Unions, OCHU, a central bargaining structure giving hospital workers one united, democratic voice and more power at the bargaining table. Hospital workers were stronger than ever.
So we have inherited a history of courage and militancy, and you know, it stood us well.
I'm telling you, we're dancing and screaming up and down that hall. They thought we were going to lose it, and the union was back, and it would grow, and
that's
it would
right.
Get too strong again.
The only regret I have from that strike, really, is that when being sentenced, I didn't stand up and tell the judge to go himself.
After decades of attacks from Liberal and Conservative governments, Ontarians wanted change. In 1990, QP members mobilized around the provincial election. in a powerful rejection of the governing Liberal Party, voters elected 74 NDP members, giving the party its first majority government.
I was heavily involved, actually, in the NDP at that time. I was the president of my riding association. It was an incredible moment. It was like the whole world had transformed because something like this had never happened in Ontario before.
In its early days, the NDP government passed important labor legislation like anti-scab laws and automatic card check certification. 1991 saw the Employment Equity Commission established, and in 1993, laws improved the number of women, racialized workers, Aboriginal workers, and workers with disabilities in the public sector. By midterm, facing a deepening recession and intense lobbying by Bay Street, the government took a sharp political turn, introducing the social contract.
Mr. Speaker, the government will introduce legislation in the legislature on Monday to enable implementation of the key elements of the framework agreement negotiated at the social contract table.
Now, the social contract idea, in many respects, came from Judy Darcy and myself because we were looking at QPBC that had sat down with an NDP government. So we essentially talked to Ray with other union leaders about his problem and his concerns around a ballooning deficit in Ontario. We never imagined for one moment that his vision of a social contract would be that he would publicly call all the union leaders together with employers and with government all in the same room at the same time and lay down the lumber and tell us that you're going to have to cough up $2 billion from public sector wages. We never envisioned for half a second that this is what he had in mind. Very quickly, the mood changed when they saw that unions weren't just willing to willy-nilly open up their collective agreements, that there was going to be a fight here.
Recognizing the need for collective action, QP Ontario called for a public services coalition to push back against the social contract.
So we figured by forming a common front, we would sort of push back and he would get to see that there's roughly a million public sector workers in Ontario, and if they were all on the same page, that he wasn't going to be able to create this divide and conquer kind of a strategy.
Realizing the importance of maintaining political action and mobilizing, even after electing a friendly government, QP Ontario had re-energized its organizing and coalition, which would become essential for meeting the challenges of the following Mike Harris era.
The results, an astounding 500,000 jobs are at risk.
1995 saw the election of Mike Harris. This anti-union, anti-public sector government began a bitter campaign of unilateral public service cuts.
As of today, Ontario is open for business.
Demonizing employment equity legislation and targeting the public service as a whole, QP member mobilization went into high gear. Social service workers in childcare were the first to take action against the Harris cuts.
We really made a conscious effort to actually take a stand and show not just our employer but the rest of the province that taking back our wage enhancement grants or trying to eliminate them was unacceptable.
The Ontario Coalition for Better Childcare and QP Ontario organized a one-day strike to raise awareness and fight back against cuts to wage enhancement grants.
So we got about 5,000 people out with the parents. We actually worked with the parents and brought them to Queen's Park to protest these cuts because people knew that if these workers were good at, in terms of their wages and benefits, and most of these are post-secondary educated employees, they're going to leave the system. And of course, that would leave the system high and dry that parents depended upon. It was a huge success. All kinds of childcare centres closed across the city and across Ontario. And we actually backed the government down.
It made a big impact on our staff because we were very young and we didn't think that collectively we could make a difference.
If you can work with your community partners, if you can work with parents, with average citizens, together with unions, it's a powerful alliance that we ought to be able to build upon, and we did.
And we are going to build a movement of opposition to this government, the likes of which Ontario has never seen before.
On a cold December day in London, 12,000 people rallied. From there, the days of action grew across Ontario. until more than 200,000 people took to the streets of Toronto in October 1996.
This is the largest demonstration of workers and their friends in our lifetime. But this worries Harris as it should, and we should keep on worrying Harris until the point where we bring him down.
Power in the lands, power in the hand of the worker. But it all amounts to nothing if together we don't stand there. There's power in a union. Now the lessons of the past were good workers' blood. Mistakes of the bosses we must pay for. From the cities and the farmlands to trenches full of mud, wars always been the bosses' wiser. The union forever.
One of the main threats was Bill 136, which, among other things, limited public sector workers' right to strike. QP members mobilized to send a strong message that there would be a province-wide strike if Bill 136 was not repealed. In September 1997, the Minister of Labour announced amendments to Bill 136 that restored workers' rights to strike.
Our proposed amendments address completely the union's concerns about what Bill 136.
Massive grassroots, member and community mobilization allowed QP and its allies to drive Harris from office. Harris's attacks had the inverse effect he had desired as QP membership grew. With the defeat of Harris, most Ontarians breathed a sigh of relief. The new premier, Dalton McGuinty, promised to rebuild the province's battered public services, calling himself the education premier. The time was right for QP Ontario and community activists to push for gains in human rights. It was a landmark settlement in 2003 that resulted in almost 100,000 workers in predominantly female public sector workplaces receiving almost $414 million in pay equity funding. This era saw same-sex marriage legalized, anti-bullying laws passed, and a bill protecting transgender rights, all of which QP Ontario actively campaigned for. QP Ontario also backed school board member Martine Stonehouse in her landmark case to have gender reassignment surgery relisted with Ontario's public health system. The struggle to advance the rights of women, LGBTQ workers, workers with disabilities, racialized workers, and Aboriginal workers dates back decades and is at the core of QP's beliefs. In 1968, National Vice President Shirley Carr made a submission to the Royal Commission on the Status of Women and stated, "We would like to see laws to prevent employers from discriminating in hiring. We would like wage rates to be the same for men and women, and we want to eliminate discrimination in promotions, transfers, and all other aspects of employment." At the 1971 National Convention in Thunder Bay, QP adopted a 9-point program on women's rights that called for affirmative action, equal pay, and enhanced benefits in collective agreements. In 1980, QP Ontario formed a women's committee, the first of its now 6 equality committees. In 1985, QP Ontario joined the Equal Pay Coalition, fighting for strong pay equity legislation for all workers and launched the biggest ever equal pay claim in the province. In each era, even despite sometimes hostile anti-labor governments, QP Ontario and its allies have been successful in campaigning for improved human rights.
Listen to these, they're really important for our time.
But the recent McGuinty government provided a stark reminder that progress on some rights does not prevent attacks on other rights, particularly workers' rights. In 2012, with Bill 115, McGuinty directly attacked the right of school board workers to free collective bargaining. QP Ontario immediately launched a full-scale campaign against the legislation, standing up not only for the education workers directly affected, but all workers' collective bargaining rights. In the months that followed, QP Ontario launched a legal challenge to the bill. members protested across the province, and public opinion of Premier Dalton McGuinty sank, forcing him to announce his resignation on October 17th. Workers dogged Liberal leadership candidates into the winter, culminating in a huge demonstration of nearly 30,000 workers outside the Liberal Leadership Convention in Toronto. The government repealed Bill 115 on January 23rd, only after using it to impose contracts on education workers. It was a bitter fight, but one that brought QP members together and once again showed all political parties our union would stand against any attack on collective bargaining rights.
I think what our history has taught us is that QP Ontario is part of a social movement, and what that means is that our work is never done. It doesn't matter who's in government, whether we think they're our friends or whether we know they're our enemies. We have an obligation to continue to mobilize, to continue to work with coalition partners, to continue to reach out to our communities, because the work of improving our communities, of making the future better, is never done.
Looking back at QP Ontario's first 50 years, one thing is abundantly clear. When QP members mobilize, when they stand together in solidarity, there is nothing they can't do.
I'm proud to be part of a transformation that our members are making to our union, to have it be reflective and inclusive and stronger as a result. And so I'm incredibly proud to be part of that history that we're making today.
Management is seeking a complete concession package across the board of our collective agreement.
Young workers are among the lowest paid in our society. They are stuck in casual, temporary, part-time, low-wage work. So we need to bring young workers along so that they can, you know, value the importance of the collective agreements. They can come on board, they can learn from us, and they can prepare to lay the groundwork for the next 50 years.
This year, in 2013, 50 years later, we have five sectors, and all of the five sectors are chaired by women, which is totally amazing.
Since QP Ontario became QP Ontario 50 years ago, the demographics has changed, and they've changed significantly. And so the majority of people that are in the province of Ontario today are racialized.
We all own a part, and that even though our voice could be small, but when we're brought together, we have a very loud voice.
Looking ahead at the challenges we face, anti-union legislation threatened by conservatives at all levels of government, QP is ready to fight for a new generation of workers, to continue a proud tradition of advancing human rights and standing up for fairness and public services for all Ontarians.
And now, sisters and brothers, let me introduce to you one of QP's founding fathers, Brother Keeley Cummings. A worker at what was then called Ontario Hydro, Keeley was a member of the National Union of Public Service Employees back in 1963. He was on the merger committee that worked for 6 years to bring together his union and the National Union of Public Employees to form QP.
Keeley served in many union positions since first getting active. In 1975, he was elected National Secretary Treasurer of QP and worked alongside National President Grace Hartman and then National President Jeff Rose. Keeley is one of the few who can tell the story of QP's founding firsthand, and we are honored and privileged to have him here with us now. Sisters and brothers, Keeley Cummings.
Thank you very much.
It's an absolute delight to be here for the 50th anniversary. Quite honestly, we've got to do a little looking to the background, and we find out that we were here longer than 50 years, because quite honestly, in 1947, when I became an Ontario Hydro employee, the first thing I did was join the union. The result, of course, was that I became active on the executive both provincially and federally, and I also took part in the co-founding of CUPE. It was a rather nasty affair initially, because there were some disagreements regarding what steps we should take to protect the public employees across the province. It meant in some cases that we had to go on strike. We had to, with Grace Hartman, Ray Arsenault, and others, had to go to jail. I found out it was best not to go to the office or you'd be there with them. So I lived across the road and I worked from there. The interesting part is when the merger did take place between NUPSI, which was in existence before the founding of CUPE, and NUPE, we realized that the parties should make an effort to put together CUPE in a very aggressive way. And we did that. We did by having strikes where necessary, getting settlements where at all possible without having to go on strike. We set up the divisional structure. We set up area councils. We set up federations of labor within the CLC and became active in all areas of that, as well as going to the international stage of the Public Services International, where we held representation throughout the world. As well, we've had the opportunity of seeing a good number of CUPE background individuals become active politically in the organization, and the picture of Judy sitting in the legislature, others did it as well. I came close in 67 and 71, but close is only good in horseshoes. The important part of the whole examination was that we realized that there was a need to be involved politically. Initially, it became a very tense affair to reach out and get individuals to become politically active. And the political party, of course, that we became involved in, with the CCF and then the Canadian Union, the part of the co-founder. I sat for 15 years on the executive of the NDP and ran twice as a candidate in 67 and 71. The whole process of making sure that our voice was going to be well heard is that we attended the conferences, we attended the divisions, we attended the political meetings no matter where they were held. And we expressed our view firmly and strongly. And by so doing, we activated the rank and file members. Now, this was a major step in the right direction. And we had to become involved, of course, as the film indicated, to establish a number of strikes throughout the province. But the bottom line is we now have an organization that started off in 1963 with 63,000 members, and we now have over 700,000, the largest union by far in the Canadian Labour Congress, and happy to be there. So It's a delight to come and speak to you. I have no intention of rolling up my carpet and leaving. I enjoyed very, very much representing workers. I still do. We have retirees and retiree functions of employees that have negotiated a collective agreement that says that if you negotiate something for a regular employee, you give it to the retiree as well. So with that, I express my appreciation of being invited and hope that you all enjoy yourself, and that looking back respectively for a 50-year period, quite honestly, as I said at the outset, it was a longer period than 50 years because we went back to 1947. Anyway, in any event, it's been a pleasure to be here, and it continues to be a pleasure representing workers, whether they are working or whether they're retirees. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kelly. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. We really have no idea what that means to all of our
guys. I'm really looking for it.
Brother Keeley, my name is Teresa Yeh. I'm a child care worker, and I'm on the member of the QP Ontario Young Workers Committee. On behalf of the next generation of the QP members here in this hall and across the province, I thank you from the bottom of my heart for your life's work at building a better world for me and my coworkers. As you know, young workers do not feel a lot of hope these days. Good jobs are far and few between. We have to put more hours in schooling than any previous generation, but we can't find decent work to give back everything we have learned. QP provides us with a chance to make change. QP gives us a better working condition. QP is an organized force that is all about building a better world for all the generations to come. We would like to take this opportunity to thank you for that, and we pledge to you and all the other officers that we will work hard to keep building a union and keep up the fight. Thank you.
Can you read that into the microphone so you know what it says?
Oh no. And it says, at our 50th annual convention, the members of QP Ontario wish to express our gratitude to Keeley Cummings. Thank you for being a part of this historical event, for your long service to our union, sisters and brothers, for your role in creating QP half a century ago, in solidarity, the members of QP Ontario.
The people united can never be defeated. 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 The communities united are preserving for... hold on, sorry. I'm really nervous. Our communities united are preserving our equality. The unions came together under this new etymology. National in scope and in service of the people, two bodies came together, formed a unified sequel, QP. 50 years of rising up the voices of workers in Ontario to give them better choices, fighting for the right to bargain as a collective, engaging in political action from the perspective of hundreds of thousands engaged in public service. Y'all are still here and make the other side nervous. 240,000 people stand strong. Your right to fight for rights when what's left must be wrong. The song that we're singing must be heard loud and audibly. Community united, preserving equality, because the people united can never be defeated. 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 The journey to this point was never easy or straight. Common goals and common action only come through debate, but the union perseveres because it's guided by your passion. And in that fashion, no opposition can be matching. The product of the actions that QP has been taking over five decades of our history in the making. Since 1963, the way to be is making change to our social institutions when we need to rearrange conditions so the province can become the very best of what we all can manifest once our labors coalesced. Bound to the principle of justice for the masses, the power of the people always proves that it surpasses efforts at suppression or at worker exploitation. The proof is in the pudding of the union's reputation. The song that we're singing must be heard loud and audibly. The people united, preserving our equality. The people united can never be defeated. 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 People from up north can never be defeated. And people from the east can never be defeated. Southwestern people can never be defeated. And from the GTA, we can never be defeated. Municipal employees can never be defeated. Healthcare workers can never be defeated. Universities and airlines can never be defeated. Service agencies and boards can never be defeated. Moving to the future, we can never be defeated. Because we fight for justice, we can never be defeated. Victory is coming, we can never be defeated. The workers of Ontario can never be defeated. The people united 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 can, come on everybody. The people united can never be defeated. The people united can never be defeated. The people united can never be defeated. The people united can never, come on! The people united can never be defeated. The people united can never be defeated. The people united can never be defeated. The people united can never be defeated.
Thank you, Ritalin. Ritalin is a community activist who has developed a reputation for powerful poetry on issues that matter. He's a regular contributor to CBC's Here and Now. And so well said by Teresa and Ritalin, our work must continue. The best way for all of us to pay tribute to QP Ontario's 50 years of history is to keep building.
QP has launched a province-wide grassroots campaign called Stand Up for Fairness. It's a campaign that asks every local to reach out to and speak to every single one of our members and ask that they recommit and re-engage in QP. QP members are getting trained up to talk to their fellow members about our union, to talk about how the gains we make benefit all workers, about how we are building strength to fight the threats to our bargaining rights and our union rights in general. We are asking members to take a pledge to stand up together.
On your tables, you will find a pledge form that looks like this. If you're watching at home, you can sign the card by going to standupforfairness.ca. You can tweet about the pledge with the hashtag QPPledge. We're going to pledge together now, and once you've signed your card, give it to one of your sisters or brothers close by who will sign and verify on behalf of our union.
Okay. So, sisters and brothers, we're going to start to sign our pledges together now. So, together, let's everybody stand up for fairness.
Good worker, you see you, I'll tell. This country is a fit and just nation. It gives opportunity to our generation.
So what side are you on?
I think it's quite simple.
So what side are you on?
Yo, I'm down for the people.
My daddy was a worker and I'm a working son. I'll stick with the union till every battle's won.
So which side are you on?
I think the answer's simple.
So which side are you on?
Yo, I'm down for my people.
Yo, a hardworking woman, this is my mother. I'll stick with the union because I am a daughter.
So what side are you on?
I think the answer's simple.
Yo, what side are you on?
I'm down for the people.
I don't scare for the bosses, I don't listen to the lies. I believe that we workers have to organize.
So what side are you on?
I think the answer's simple.
What side are you on?
I'm down with my people.
All you good workers, when you see you, I'll tell of how the good old union has come in here to dwell. And all you good workers, when you see you, I'll tell of how the good old union has come in here to dwell.
I believe in myself, in my work, in my power. Stand for the union cause the workers no power.
So which side are you on?
Yo, I think the answer's simple.
So which side are you on?
Yo, I'm down for my people.
I believe in myself and I must get paid. So I'm down with the union so I won't get paid.
So what side are you on?
I think the answer's simple.
So what side are you on?
Yo, I'm down for my people.
I believe in the workers, I keep the city together. I believe in the union, solidarity forever.
So which side are you on?
I think the answer's simple.
So which side are you on?
I'm down for my people.
I believe in equality and justice for all. I believe in the union, and so I stand tall.
So what side are you on?
I think the answer's simple.
What side are you on?
I'm dancing with my people.
All you good workers, when you see you, I'll tell of how the good old union has come in here to dwell. All you good workers, when you see you, I'll tell of how the good old union.
In myself, in my work, in my power. I stand for the union cause the workers no power.
So which side are you on?
Yo, I think the answer's simple.
So which side are you on?
Yo, I'm down for my people.
I believe in myself and I must get paid. So I'm down with the union so I won't get played.
So what side are you on?
I think the answer's simple.
So what side are you on?
Yo, I'm down for my people.
I believe in the workers, I keep the city together. I believe in the union, solidarity forever.
So which side are you on?
I think the answer's simple.
So which side are you on?
I'm down for my people.
I believe in equality and justice for all. I believe in the union and so I stand tall.
So which side are you on?
I think the answer's simple.
What side are you on?
I'm down with my people.
All you good workers, when you see you, I'll tell of how the good old union has come in here to dwell. All you good workers, when you see you, I'll tell of how the good old union.
Okay, so sisters and brothers, after you've signed your cards, if it hasn't already been collected, hold up your card and the volunteers will be picking them up.
Okay. Now, let's get ready for some more action, because we are going to march together to the Ministry of Labor to let them know that we are here to defend our right to free collective bargaining. Woo!